Welcome back. Our next subject is going to be on the states of matter, right? And this is not like California and Nevada matter. This is the states of matter, which to a chemist consists primarily of solids, liquids, and gases. Now, you will see people occasionally also include what's called a plasma in here, and you may hear that term here and there. Those are rare because you have to have very, very high temperatures in order to do it, several thousand Kelvin, very, very hot. And so you don't find them often in daily life. So we're going to talk primarily about the states of matter being a solid, a liquid, and a gas. But what we want to talk about next is what distinguishes a solid, liquid, and a gas so that we can talk about it and say, oh, that's what we mean when we say we've got a solid. So we're going to talk about a few things. What happens to a solid when you put it in a container, right? It's got a fixed shape, right? You take a block of wood and you put it into a container, it's still the same block of wood. And so solids are definitely known for having a fixed shape. What about liquids? If you take a liquid and you put it into a container, what does it do? It takes the shape of the container. What about a gas? A gas, it's a little hard to think of because we can't generally see gases, but if you take a balloon and you squeeze the balloon and move it around, does the gas just kind of sit in the middle of it, or does it fill the balloon no matter what shape it is? And the answer is it fills the balloon no matter what shape it is. And so this also takes the shape of container. Next, I want you to take a solid object and then try to squeeze it. You can't really squeeze a solid object, can you, very well? It has a fixed volume, a fixed volume. What about a liquid? If you try to take a 2 liter bottle of soda and you try to squeeze, it doesn't squeeze very well because there's a fixed volume to a liquid as well. Now, in all truth, it turns out the volume of solids and liquids can change ever so slightly with temperature. So you warm things up, things tend to get a little bigger. If you cool them down, they generally get a little smaller. That's why if you drive across a long bridge, you go thump, 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 because there's expansion gaps in the bridge. For when it gets hot, it can expand, and when it's cool, it can contract a little without breaking the bridge. They design that in. But what about a gas? Well, think about a bike pump. If you take a bike pump and you put your finger over the end and you can push down on the, you can push the handle a little bit. It's the same amount of gas in there because you plugged it. So we have something that has a volume that can change. We're going to call this compressible. A gas is compressible. Okay? So we've talked about shape, we've talked about volume. What else are we going to talk about? How about density? What do we know about the density of some of these substances? A solid, right? When you think of a solid, you think maybe a rock. You toss a rock into water, what happens? It sinks. You toss a rock in the air, what does it do? Like, well, what do you mean, what does it do? It falls to the ground because of gravity. But what's it actually doing? It's sinking in air. So we generally consider solids to have fairly high density. What about liquids? Well, you'd be like, well, the rock sinks in a liquid, so maybe it has a liquid has a lower density than solids. But think about what ice does in water. Ice floats in water because it's less dense than water. And so you say, well, solids are less dense than liquids. Turns out that they're just pretty close, okay? So we also consider liquids to have high density. But what about gases? I mean, this air that's around me right here, is it dense? Well, not really, right? So I take even a light ball like this and I drop it, it'll sink in air. So air, gases, tend to have a very low density. Here's another question. Does air sink? Have you ever had to like walk into a room and like bend down and be like
I gotta breathe the air on the bottom because way up here there's just not enough air.
No. The air fills the room. So is air not sinking? Well, it turns out air is sinking, because if you go up a really, really tall mountain, how much air is there, right? People who climb Mount Everest, they have to bring oxygen with them because there's not much air up there. Up in space, there's no air, which means the air is sinking. But why don't we experience this in a room? Is because it's sinking, yes, but it's also moving very, very quickly, which we'll talk about in just a moment. It's moving very, very quickly, so in the size of a room, it's bouncing around so much that we can't even tell there's a difference. All right, so gases have low density. Let's talk about molecular motion next. Solid, sitting there. Are the molecules moving at all? And it turns out they are. Even in a solid, molecules are moving. At the very least, they're sitting there vibrating. And sometimes they're actually migrating around inside the solid. So that can happen, but we call this low molecular motion. Some people will say no molecular motion, but there's a little bit, but definitely very little. I mean, it's not like when you stick your iPhone on the desk that it starts, you know, wandering away all on its own, unless someone steals it, and that's just different. All right, what about a liquid? Is there any motion in a liquid? Now let's think about a liquid, not that we're swirling, because we're like, hey, there's some motion in there, right? If I chuck a ball, there's motion in a solid. Let's consider a bottle of liquid that's been sitting on a shelf for 2 weeks. No one's touched it. It's on this perfectly still shelf. No one's bumped it, nothing. It's perfectly still. Is there any motion whatsoever in that liquid? And most people would kind of think about it off the top of their head. They say, no, it's pretty still. It's not moving. But if I take a drop of food coloring and just very, very, very carefully put it on top of that liquid, what's going to happen? And you've done this probably experiment before where you've done it and maybe not left a liquid for 2 weeks, but you've put food coloring to a liquid and you'll notice that it spreads and it moves out. Because even though it looks from a macroscopic scale, from what we can see with our eyes, like there's nothing going on in there, those liquid molecules are constantly moving past each other. And as they move past each other and you put the food coloring in there, they move past each other and it eventually would fill up the entire container and spread out that way. So there is some molecular motion. In a liquid. And of course, when you pour the liquid, right, one particle of the liquid is moving past the other particle. When you pour a piece of wood, those particles don't move relative to one another. But when you pour a liquid, they do. Now, what about a gas? And here's the crazy thing about a gas. A gas is moving like crazy. I mean, when you consider like the motion of a liquid, maybe it's like this. But when you consider the motion of a gas, like that, right? It's hugely crazy. I mean, these things are moving so fast. In fact, right around you, right? There's air around you, right? You can feel it. Oh, yeah, there's air. Take a deep breath. But what's happening in that air? That air, how fast do you think it's moving? 10 miles an hour? I mean, if somebody opens something smelly on one side of a room, it might take, you know, a minute or two to get to the other side of the room. So maybe the air is not moving all that fast. It's moving. No. It's crazy. The average air molecule, the average oxygen or nitrogen molecule moving across in the air in front of you and hitting you is moving at 500 miles per hour. Now imagine you got hit by a bus at 500 miles per hour. You'd be squashed, right? So how come when you're getting hit by 500 miles per hour by all these air molecules, you're not getting there squished? And it turns out, one, you are getting squished a little bit, because if you didn't get squished, it wouldn't feel so good. And two, they're tiny. We're going to learn later on about just how tiny they are. But they're tiny, 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 tiny. Imagine a toddler running up to a sumo wrestler. Boom. Sumo wrestler might not even notice, right? So you've got these tiny, tiny, tiny air molecules hitting you at 500 miles an hour, you probably don't even notice. But what we have is not just some molecular motion, but we've got huge molecular motion. And that is a very defining feature of a gas. If you've got things zooming through, then you've got yourself a gas. All right. So these are some things that will define our solids, liquids, and our gases is their shape, their volume, their density, and their molecular motion, we can look at them and say, oh, when I've got things that are moving a little bit and at high density, maybe I have a liquid. And the reason we talk about these is these start to get at some of the molecular properties of what's happening on a really, really tiny scale. And that's the fun thing in chemistry. We take what's happening on a big scale. We've got this pen, and we start looking smaller and smaller and smaller, and we say, well, why does the metal have the properties that it does? And we can look on a molecular scale or even a subatomic scale, which we'll get to later, and see what's happening in order to make a pen act like a pen. So that is our discussion of the states of matter, solid, liquid, and gas. Thank you.